Hi, I'm Dana Stahl, and this is...
Charlotte Stahl.
What day is it today, Charlie?
It is Father's Day.
Yep, it's Father's Day, and today we're going to be honoring fathers. Welcome to Have Our Assembly Online, and please join us as her daddy leads us in worship, and my daddy leads us as we study the Word. Enjoy the service.
Well, welcome to Have Our Assembly Online. I'm Pastor Jamie, and I'm happy to have you with us this morning. I would like to start this worship time off with a word from the Lord. It's from Psalm 71, verse 19, and it says this. It says, "Your righteousness, God, reaches to the heavens. You who have done great things, who is like you, God?" This first song that we're going to sing is called Great Things, and it helps us focus on who God is and what he's done. And really, the answer to that question, who is like you, God, is that no one is like God. And when you begin to realize that there is nobody like our God, your heart can't help but want to worship him for all that he's done and for all that he's going to do. Let's open in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we love you so much. We thank you that you do great things, that you've done great things, and that you're going to continue in the future to do even more than we could ever ask or think or imagine. Lord, we love you and we praise you. Mm-hmm. Lord, when we think about all that you've done, all that we can stop and say is, who is like you, God? And the answer is absolutely no one. Mm-hmm. Lord, help us to recognize who you are. Help us to worship you with all of our hearts, minds, souls, and strength. Lord, we love you and praise you.
Yes, Lord.
Be glorified in your mighty name, Jesus. Amen.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great. Above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable. Every chain, oh God, you have is a hallelujah. In the presence of my enemies, I raise a hallelujah. Louder than the unbelief, I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody, I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Darkness flee, I raise a hallelujah. In the middle of the mystery, I raise a hallelujah. Fear you lost your hold on me.
To fight for.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Hallelujah, Lord.
Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou.
Think of all that you've done, all that you do, Lord, and all that you continue to do in our life, Lord. We can't help but declare how great you are. Lord, help us live lives that reflect your greatness.
Yes.
As we live surrendered lives to you.
Yes.
As we live lives that honor you.
Help us.
And declare your glory wherever we go. Lord, as we continue in this service this morning, I pray that you will just glorify yourself.
Yes.
Make yourself known to us and through us. Lord, we pray this in your mighty name. Amen.
Well, are you ready to get into the Word of God? I sure am. Today we're going to be in the book of 1 Samuel in the Old Testament. And the title of today's sermon is Standing Tall, Falling Hard. And the three guys we're going to talk about today, Eli, Samuel, and Saul, all fit that description, but mostly Saul. But before we even get into that, I'd like to share a quick story. When I was a freshman in high school, I was extremely short, 4'10 to be exact, and had a tendency to get picked on because I was a short boy with a big mouth. And I know you find that hard to believe. So I made friends with a giant by the name of Ian Ritchie. And I think he was 6'3", 6'4", almost Pete Everingham's size. And he was a grade ahead of me. And I remembered as long as Ian was with me, nobody messed with me. But if I wasn't with Ian, I better watch out. Well, he reminds me of the standing tall part. Let's get into this morning. First of all, we start off with a lady by the name of Hannah. And Hannah's married to a man by the name of Elkanah. And he is also married to another woman named Peninnah. Now, in their family, Peninnah was able to have children. Hannah wasn't. And in that day and age, to not be able to have children for a woman was an incredible curse. And so every year, Elkanah loved Hannah more than he loved Peninnah. And so Peninnah would always take opportunity to poke fun at Hannah because she couldn't have children. So every year, Hannah would weep and she would cry and she would be feeling bad. Well, this particular year when they went to Shiloh for the yearly sacrifices, she went to the temple and she was praying. She was pouring out her soul. She was weeping and she made a vow to God. She said, "If you'll bless me with a son, I will give him to you all the days of his life." Well, as she's praying in the temple, she's not speaking out loud. And Eli, the priest, sees this woman in there who seems to be carrying on but isn't vocalizing anything, and he mistakenly thinks she's drunk. So he approaches her and says, "Woman, what are you doing in here drunk?" And Hannah says, "Oh, please, that is not it at all. Here's what's happening in my life. Here's what I need." And she explains herself, and Eli tells her, "Go in peace. The Lord has heard your prayer." So she goes home, and it isn't that long afterwards that Samuel, her firstborn son, comes along. And Samuel means asked of God, which is exactly what she did. Well, she told her husband Elkanah, "Hey, I'm not going down to the yearly sacrifice until Samuel is weaned. And after Samuel is weaned, then I will bring him and we will leave him there for ministry." So they did that. I think he probably was 3 years old. And when he got to be that age, they brought him, and Hannah brought him to the priest Eli and said, "You may not remember me, but several years ago I made a vow to the Lord, and you told me that God would hear my prayer, and so here is my firstborn son, Samuel. There's been no razor touch his head, and he is set apart to the Lord. Here he is." Imagine that must have surprised Eli incredibly. But Samuel ended up being quite a blessing to him. And the Lord blessed Hannah when she went back home. The Bible tells us she had 3 more sons and 2 more daughters. So Samuel grew up before the Lord. And the Bible tells us that the word of the Lord was extremely rare in those days. There was no widespread revelation. So people were not used to hearing from God. They were not used to God talking to people at all. Well, as the story goes, one night as young Samuel is going to bed, he's laying in his bed and he hears a voice, "Samuel, Samuel." And he thinks, "Oh, Eli's calling me." So he runs to Eli's room and he says, "Here I am, you called." Eli says, "No, I didn't call you, Samuel. Go back to bed." Samuel goes back to bed. It isn't long. He hears it again. "Samuel, Samuel." Runs to Eli's room again. "Hey, I know you called me." Eli says, No, I didn't. go back and lie down. Samuel goes back a third time, lays down. Hears the voice again. Samuel, Samuel, runs to Eli's room. I know you called me, Eli. What is it that you need? No, I didn't call you. By now, Eli knows something's up. He said, you go back to your bed, and when that happens again, this is what I want you to say. Speak, for your servant is listening. So Samuel goes back, and it isn't long, and God speaks again and says, Samuel, Samuel. And this little boy, Samuel, responds by saying, speak, for your servant is listening. Let's look at that verse just briefly. What does that really mean? He's saying, Lord, I'm ready to hear your voice. Speak. And not only am I ready to hear your voice, my ears are tuned up. It's not happenstance hearing. I am listening for your voice. Very directive and very on purpose. And you know what? That's how God wants you and I to listen for his voice. Not hope it happens. Not, come see, come saw. We'll just see how it goes. No, God wants us to be listening intently for his voice to see what he's going to say to us. Well, Samuel did that. And unfortunately, the news was not good. You see, Eli had two older sons, Hophni and Phinehas. And these two older boys really desecrated the temple. They would not cook the sacrifices. They would take advantage of the people. They would do even worse things than that. Eli scolded them, but they were never corrected. And so God's name and the reputation of the temple was pretty bad in those days. And what God told Samuel, he said, this is what's going to happen. Because Eli has not taken care of his family, because his sons have desecrated my temple and made sullied my reputation and my name's reputation, my temple's reputation, then I'm going to destroy Eli and his family. The next day, Samuel gets up and Eli calls him right away and says, Samuel, I want you to tell me everything that the Lord told you. And if you don't tell me, I hope that whatever bad that he told you happens to you. Well, that's quite a threat, but it does let me know that Eli had an inkling that the news was negative. Otherwise, he wouldn't have spoken that way to Samuel. So Samuel says, okay, here it is. God says you have not disciplined your sons, and his temple and his name has been sullied, and because of that, you're not going to continue as the priest. Your family is going to be destroyed. And amazingly enough, Eli says, well, let it be as the Lord says. And he doesn't get mad at Samuel. They just keep going on with life. Well, it isn't too long after that, and the Israelites have a battle with the Philistines. And during this battle, Israel gets whooped terrible. So bad that the Philistines are able to capture the Ark of God, and Eli's two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, are killed. Well, a messenger comes back and delivers this news to Eli, the priest, that his sons have been killed and that the Ark of God has been captured by the Philistines. When he hears about the Ark of God being captured, which he's responsible for, the Bible says he was a big man and he fell over in his chair, broke his neck, and he died. So all three of them, just like Samuel said, just like the Lord had told him, passed away. Now Eli had been Israel's judge for 40 years. Well, the Ark of God, you don't have to worry about the Ark of God. God can take care of himself. The Philistines take the Ark of God to their God's temple, Dagon, and they put the Ark in there with Dagon. They wake up the next morning and Dagon is crumbled in pieces and laying at the foot of the Ark of God. Anywhere where they put the Ark of God, people would be cursed. People would be sick. Finally, the Philistines didn't know what to do with the Ark of God, so they sent it back to Israel, which is kind of an interesting story in and of itself. So we find that Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. Oh, I wish that could be said of you and me, that none of our words, that the Lord would let none of our words fall to the ground. What does that mean? It means when Samuel spoke, everyone listened, because he always spoke as of the Lord and what the Lord would be speaking to him and through him. Unfortunately, as he got older, he had a couple of sons, Joel and Abijah, and he appointed them as Israel's judges, and they worked down in Beersheba. But these two sons were not good judges. They were not good priests. They took dishonest gain. They took bribes. They perverted justice. And they did not walk in the ways of Samuel, their father. So we get to Judges chapter 3. Oh, well, actually, that's a verse from a couple sermons ago. And it's a disturbing trend that we see happening here from the time of the judges to Eli's family to Samuel's family. Let's look at these verses together. Judges, it says, after that generation died, another generation grew up who did not acknowledge the Lord or remember the mighty things he had done for Israel. These are the people that came after Joshua. Well, then we find in 1 Samuel 3:13, speaking of Eli, for I've told him that I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knows, because his sons made themselves vile and he did not restrain them. Eli's sons, next generation. Then we look at 1 Samuel 8:3, speaking of Samuel. But his sons did not walk in his ways. They turned aside after dishonest gain, took bribes, and perverted justice. What do we see happening? Again and again, we see the next generation not following in the footsteps of their parents, particularly their fathers. Now, this is a sad state of affairs, but it was the way things were in Israel. And it could be said that maybe it's that way in the United States of America, or maybe in our world. But does it have to be that way? And the answer is no, it doesn't. And we'll get to that. Well, because it was like this, and the Israelites didn't trust Samuel's sons, they trusted Samuel, but they didn't trust his kids. They said to him in 1 Samuel 8, 5-7, look, Samuel, you are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Saul when they said, give us a king to judge us. So Samuel prayed to the Lord. And the Lord said to Samuel, heed the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. What was the point that God was making? Well, I can remember when I was a younger person, I would say to my parents, if I wanted something, I'd say, well, everyone else has got one of those. I want one too. In high school, it was hiking boots and corduroy pants. That was the big thing. If you were cool, you wore corduroy pants and hiking boots. Didn't matter what time of year it was in New Hampshire, those things were in. I just had to have those. Why? Because everybody's got them. And if people were doing different things socially, I'd say, well, I want to go do this. Well, why do you want to go do this? Well, everybody else is doing it. And I can remember both my parents saying from time to time, well, hey, if everybody's walking across a cliff to their death, should you do that too? Just because everybody else is doing it or everybody else has one doesn't mean you should. And that's how God felt about the Israelites wanting a king. They wanted a king because everyone else had one. They didn't need a king. They had God. And so they rejected the Lord. But God told Samuel, go ahead, let's anoint a king. And he tells him about a man that he's going to meet real soon, a man by the name of Saul. He said, you'll know him because he's going to be looking for some lost donkeys. Well, sure enough, the next day, Saul and his servant show up looking for donkeys. And they find out that Samuel's a man of God. He lives in the town. Hey, could you help us find our lost donkeys? Well, sure. In fact, they're found already. And I have more news for you. Oh, what's that? Well, God has chosen you to be the next king. What? And Saul was a very, very tall man. The Bible said head and shoulders above everybody else. But he just couldn't believe that that was what God wanted of him. Nevertheless, Samuel anointed Saul the first king of Israel. And some very interesting things happened to Saul as he was leaving. We find it in 1 Samuel 10, 6 through 9. Then the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you, and you will prophesy with them and be turned into another man. And let it be when these signs come to you that you do as the occasion demands, for God is with you. You shall go down before me to Gilgal, and surely I will come down to you to offer burnt offerings and make sacrifices of peace offerings. 7 days you shall wait till I come to you and show you what you should do. So it was when he turned his back to go from Samuel that God gave him another heart, and all those signs came to pass that day. A change happened in Saul's life. Why? Because God was outfitting him, equipping him to be Israel's first king. You see, he was chosen by God, but he was nervous about it. He was timid, and when Samuel actually revealed it to the Israelite nation, they couldn't find Saul. Come to find out, he was hiding amongst the equipment. And then they brought him out, and he stood up, and wow, taller than everyone else. He was chosen by God, but he was jealous. He was impatient. He was impetuous at times. Nevertheless, he was able to lead the people into battle, and the people loved to rally around this tall, central figure of a leader. And he was able to forge a nation out of local tribes of people. Well, there was a battle came up. A man by the name of Nahash, the Ammonite, decided he was going to pick on the Israelite people living in Jabesh Gilead. Aren't you glad there will not be a test later on all these place names and people names? And he said, you know what? I'll make a covenant with you if you let us come and remove the right eyes of every one of the men. That does not sound like a good deal. So the people of Jabesh Gilead said, before we make this covenant with you, let us send word out to the rest of our countrymen, see if anybody will come help us. If no one's going to come help us, then I guess we'll agree to that. Well, they sent the word out. King Saul, who really hadn't been totally and completely publicly recognized yet because he was timid at first and people weren't sure they wanted him to be their leader, he hears about it, and the Spirit of the Lord comes upon him, and he is able to raise an army of 330,000 people. That's like 2.5 Billings population. That was the army he raised. Monumental army. They experienced an incredible victory, and King Saul now became recognized as, wow, he really does have the goods. He really is a leader. So in 1 Samuel 11, 14, and 15, Samuel says to the people, come, let us go to Gilgal and renew the kingdom there. So all the people went to Gilgal, and there they made Saul king before the Lord in Gilgal. They made sacrifices of peace offerings before the Lord, and there Saul and all the men of Israel rejoiced. So things are looking pretty good. For King Saul, looking pretty good for the nation of Israel. Samuel gives them good advice. 1 Samuel 12, 14. If you fear the Lord, where have you heard that before? Serve him. Heard that before? Obey his voice. Oh, I know we've heard that before. And do not rebel against the commandments of the Lord. Yes, we've heard that before. Then both you and the king who reigns over you will continue following the Lord your God. Samuel gave us again the same keys that Joshua did, the same keys that Moses did. Fear the Lord, serve him, obey his voice, do not rebel against the commandments of the Lord. That's how you follow the Lord your God. Samuel also told him, you know, God isn't really pleased that you decided you needed to have a king. And the people were very sorry, actually, about that. They said, well, please pray for us because we don't want God to stay mad at us. And then Samuel said to the people, do not fear. You have done all this wickedness. Yet, do not turn aside from following the Lord, but serve the Lord with all your heart. Don't turn aside, for then you'd go after empty things which cannot profit or deliver, for they are nothing. Oh, that's good advice for them. That's good advice for you and me. Sometimes we do wickedness. Sometimes we displease the Lord. But Samuel says, don't let that deter you completely from following the Lord. Don't let it turn you. Don't let it turn you aside. For then you'll go after empty things which don't profit or deliver. If you and I aren't careful, that same thing can happen to us. Satan likes to use sin in our life or things that happen that are displeasing the Lord and tell us that you don't stand a chance following the Lord because you did this. He's wrong. Samuel's telling these people, yes, you did this wickedness, but don't turn aside from following the Lord. All is not lost. All is not hopeless. You can still follow the Lord. We can get this thing turned around. And you know what? This can be turned around in your life too, and in mine. Again, he says in verse 24 of chapter 12, only fear the Lord. Serve him in truth with all your heart. For consider what great things he has done for you. Again, such great advice for you and I. Fear the Lord. Serve him in truth with all your heart. And I like this last one. Consider what great things he has done for you. You know, the Lord has done great things for you and for me. We just need to bring them to our remembrance from time to time. Well, it's also interesting because Samuel, as their leader, makes a pledge to them. It's in verse 23 of chapter 12. He says, moreover, as for me, far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. But I will teach you the good and the right way. You know, as I read that verse, I couldn't help but take it personally as lead pastor here at Haver Assembly. What am I supposed to be doing for you, whether I'm doing it online or whether it's in a building or on phone calls or social media or however we see each other or contact each other? I'm supposed to do the same thing. Far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. I need to be praying for you, and I do that. And I will teach you the good and the right way. You know, that's the calling of God on my life in the way that I lead you, that I would teach you the good and the right way. Well, I wish I could tell you that King Saul was able to walk in that right way, but not so much. He tried to be king, but he always was one step behind common sense. He failed to measure the strength of an enemy. He had 330,000 fighters. He sent everybody home except 3,000. He didn't measure the strength of an enemy. He impulsively took matters in his own hands when he was waiting for Samuel. 2 years later, he only had these 3,000 guys, sent everyone else home. Lots of Philistines come to fight. The people and the army scatter from King Saul. Samuel hasn't shown up yet to do the sacrifice. You know what King Saul does? He decides, everybody's leaving, so I think I'll do the sacrifice. Whoa. You might say, well, what's the big deal? The big deal is the king does not do that. The priest does that. That is Samuel's calling. That's not Saul's calling. That's Samuel's calling, and Saul takes it upon himself. He displeases the Lord by taking on something that is not his to take on. Do you think you and I could ever get in that kind of trouble where God's called us to do this, but we're too busy trying to do this, And he says, no, no, I need you. Your calling is to do this, not this. So we need to be careful. He was not careful to obey the calling of the Lord in his life. He was called to be the king, not to be the priest. So Samuel told him, the kingdom was going to be taken from him and given to someone else, a man after God's own heart. Why? Because Saul had not obeyed the Lord. Well, we have another example of that. Another battle takes place. This time, it's with the Amalekites. And God says, when you fight these guys, you better destroy everything. I don't want one person left alive. I don't want one critter left alive. It is time to punish the Amalekites, so you go do this. Well, they went out to battle, and they won the battle. But Saul kept the king alive, and his soldiers kept the livestock alive. Now, they did use them as sacrifices, but what was happening? Saul was disobeying God again, and he was leading the people to disobey God again. So, you know the story, and this verse is a very popular verse in 1 Samuel 15:22. Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Samuel says to him, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to listen than the fat of rams. Samuel is so sad that Saul has failed as the king. And he tells Saul, your time is up, buddy. It's time for me to anoint a successor. But you know what? Saul's gotten used to being the king. He's gotten used to the perks of that high office. And there is no way he's letting that go without a fight. Well, I want to back up just a little bit. Because back in 1 Samuel chapter 12, when Samuel is telling the people to fear the Lord and to serve him in truth and serve him with all their heart and to remember what the Lord has done for them and all of that advice, and he's telling them that he's going to teach them the good and perfect way and he's not going to cease to pray for them. When all of that is happening, there's a verse right in the middle there, verse 22 of chapter 12, and I just want to preach this a little bit because Samuel says these words, for the Lord will not forsake his people for his great name's sake, because it has pleased the Lord to make you his people. When I read that, I about jumped out of my chair, because this is telling me that even though the people wanted to do what everybody else wanted to do and they displeased God by wanting a king, and even though Eli had lost his life and his sons had not followed in his ways and they had lost their lives, and even though Samuel had followed the Lord but his two sons, Joel and Abijah, didn't, even though all this stuff is happening, God still says to them through Samuel, the Lord will not forsake his people. Why? Not because of their behavior, good or bad. Why? For his great name's sake. And guess what? That's good news for you and me. Because the Lord will not forsake you and I either. Why? Same reason. For his great name's sake. I'm here to tell you that if God forsaking us is dependent on your behavior and mine, we are completely sunk. We're done. We will not make it. But if the Lord staying with us is based upon his name's sake, how many know we stand a great chance of not being forsaken by the Lord? It says, because it has pleased the Lord to make you his people. Oh, hallelujah. I'm so glad that it pleases the Lord to make me his child. It pleases the Lord to make you his child. You know, we see a little bit of this in the New Testament, in the book of John, chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. Listen to the word of the Lord. But as many as received him, Jesus, to them Jesus gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, born not of blood, not of the will of the flesh, not of the will of man, but born of God. How powerful is that statement? You and I can become children of God, not because we successfully raise our children to follow in the ways of the Lord. Eli wasn't able to do that. Samuel wasn't able to do that. Not because we can always be obedient. Saul wasn't able to do that. Not because we always make good choices. The children of Israel weren't able to do that. No, we're able to become children of God, not based on our behavior, but based on what Jesus did on the cross for you and I. He made a way. He gave us the right to become children of God as we believe in His name, as we believe in what He did for us on the cross. We are given that right. We are given that privilege. It's all based on what Jesus has done. It's all based on what God has done. And brother and sister, that is such good news for you and for me. I'm so thankful that my standing with God is not based upon my performance. Now, before we go too far with that, I will say this. My standing with God, although it's not based on my performance, it certainly gets affected by it. That's why Samuel the prophet, Samuel the priest, kept telling them, hey, the reason I'm telling you to fear the Lord, to serve Him with all your heart in truth, and to remember what He's done for you, and to not turn to the left or not be swayed by these things. The reason I'm telling you that is not to spoil your day, Israelites. The reason I'm telling you that is the best way to live this life before God is in this way. You'll be blessed if you do this. You'll be cursed if you go the other way. Bad things happen the other way. But when you follow the Lord in this way, God makes the path straight. And now it doesn't mean that no bad things will ever happen in your life, but it does mean that you will be able to handle the things that life throws your way with the power of God there in you. And I need that. And you know what? You do too. So let's follow the Lord. Let's serve the Lord. Let's fear the Lord. Let's serve Him in truth. Let's remember what He's done for us. But let's never forget that our standing with God, not based on us, based on belief and trust in Him. The title of today's message is Standing Tall, Falling Hard. We can see in all three men, Eli the priest, Samuel the priest and prophet, Saul the king. Saul especially was very tall, but in every way, Eli was tall in the reputation in Israel. Samuel was extremely tall. None of his words fell to the ground, and Saul physically was tall and a capable leader. They all stood tall, and they all had ways that they or their families fell hard. We'll hear more about Saul. His is a disastrous story. Eli's was a disastrous story. I don't know that Samuel's was, other than to see his sons be like that, but Samuel followed the Lord. What did Jesus say? What's the key to not falling hard? And here's my final point. He said in John chapter 3, verse 7, you must be born from above. You must be born again. You see, back when the Spirit of the Lord came on Saul that one time we talked about, that's how it was in the Old Testament. The Spirit of the Lord would come upon people to get a certain job done or to accomplish a certain thing. But in the New Testament, when Jesus came and then the Holy Spirit came in the book of Acts, it's a new day. Because now when the Spirit of the Lord comes, He begins to change everything inside. You become a new person. You are born of the Spirit. You are born of God. And that is for keeps. That's not a come and go thing. Like, whoo-ha, whoo-ha, which is kind of how it was in the Old Testament. The Spirit of God comes to live in you. That's why the Apostle Paul says we are temples of the Holy Spirit. And That shouldn't be a scary thing. That should be a wonderful thing that God wants to empower us, live in us, and help us every day, 24 hours a day. I can use that. I need that. And so do you. So if you've not made a commitment to Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you've not trusted His sacrifice on the cross to put you in right relationship with God, if you've not done that yet, now's the time to do it. And you can pray and receive Christ in your life right now. Pray this way with me. Dear Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that like these guys and their sons, I've done things that have displeased you and made choices that are displeasing and not righteous, not good. Lord, I repent of those things. I turn away from those things and I turn my attention to you. Jesus, I turn my attention to what you did on the cross and I ask that what you did on the cross would forgive me of my sin. I place my belief and my trust completely in what you did and not what I've done. Help me as you cleanse my life, as I am born again. Create in me a new heart. Make me a new person from the inside out, and help me to love you and to follow you. In Jesus' name. Now, for those of you that you already know the Lord, you're born again, I think there's some messages there for us too. How do we follow the Lord? Serve the Lord with all your heart. Obey. Don't turn to the right or the left. Remember what the Lord has done for us. And then lastly, let's remember our children and our grandchildren. We need to do the very best that we possibly can to raise them up to experience the Lord in a very personal way so we don't end up having children like Eli had, Hophni and Phinehas, who were killed for desecrating the temple. So we don't have children like Samuel had, Joel and Abijah, who took advantage and cheated the people. We don't need that. I don't want that. I want my children to grow up and as adults serve the Lord. Fear the Lord. Remember what He has done for them and not turn aside to the right or to the left, but stay following the Lord, knowing that if they do that, their lives and their families' lives will be better. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for this word today. I pray that you'd help us as families, especially on this Father's Day. Lord, we as fathers want our children and our grandchildren to know the Lord, to serve the Lord, to experience the Lord. And we pray that you would empower us to do our level best, God, to aid in that process, knowing that at the end of the day, Lord, it's something that is between our children, grandchildren, and you. But we want to be a positive influence in that arena. We pray that you would bless each of our families and each of those families listening and watching today. Lord, bless them. Help them. Help us to move forward following Jesus. In your precious name we pray, Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you is my prayer. Happy Father's Day, dads. So I am Pastor Kurt of Haver Assembly, and this is my granddaughter,
Charlotte.
And we have a couple of presents to give to dads, don't we, today?
Yes.
It's really hard to do that online, but if we could give these to you, we would. And we want to honor all you dads. So the first thing we're going to talk about is, what is this, Charlotte?
Man of God, Rooted in Christ.
And it's a what?
A book.
It's a book of devotions for men. Do you think it's important for men and dads to read the Bible and read God's Word?
Yes.
Yeah, so we want to give them something for that. But because they're men, we also want to give them something else. Now, what do you think this is?
A leather, one of those leather things.
Letterman?
Yeah.
Well, I wish it was. It's not quite as good as one of those. But what are some of the things you see on this crazy thing?
Scissors, a knife,
okay,
and that thing.
That's a bottle opener, bottle cap opener.
And that's a screwdriver.
That's a screwdriver. And that's a smaller knife, isn't it?
I think it's kind of a nail thing that you get dirt out of your nails with.
You're right. and I can't even think of what that's called either, but that's what's on there. There's also a scripture reference on there.
Colossians 2 through 7.
Yeah, 2:7. So we're going to give these to any of the dads that are in service. So my dad's name is Greg. You know him as Papa Greg.
Yeah.
And so, Dad, if you're watching, I just want to thank you for being my dad, taking care of me, training me up in the ways of the Lord, always accepting me and loving me. And your dad's going to be watching. Would you like to say something to your dad?
He is a nice guy.
He's a nice guy? And do you appreciate him?
Yes, I appreciate him.
Do you get your sense of humor from him?
Yeah!
Oh, congratulations, dads. Happy Father's Day. Hey, this is what's coming soon at Haver Assembly. So many of us were frustrated and sad by the fact we can't have family camp at Hungry Horse this year. But I've got great news. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, July 5th, 6th, 7th, we're bringing family camp to our church. Sunday morning will feature our superintendent, Dave Phillips, preaching and the ordination service of our own Pastor Jamie, one of eight that are being ordained in that service. Then Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night, Pastor Kevin Gear from the Canvas Church will be preaching. So what we can do is I'm inviting you to our playground here. Come camp out here for family camp in the yard, bring RVs, whatever, bring food. We'll hang out, we'll have a great time. And then in the evenings and Sunday morning, we'll enjoy services and worship together. Also, Pastor Jamie would want me to remind you that high school camp, middle school camp, kids camp, they're all happening and you need to sign up your kids. You can come to our website to figure that all out. And we need adults to volunteer. So keep us informed about that. That's all for this week.
Okay, Charlie, what are we up to this weekend?
We're going to go see my great-grandparents, and on Saturday I'm going to see my...
Grandparents?
Grandparents that aren't great grandparents.
So your regular grandparents?
Yeah, my regular great grandparents.
So
not great.
Okay. So what